and in the servants of the Lord.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be the Lord.
Yes, a warm welcome to all of you joining us this morning, and a special welcome to Jeremy, Brenda, and Ruth, and
Nikki.
So we're going to stand and sing our opening song, I should say.
Oh,
Gracious God of the universe, thank you for your invitation to us to worship and praise you today. We thank you for the beauty and wonder of your creation, for its rich and varied fruits, for clean water, food, fresh air and shelter. Forgive us when we have taken the earth's resources for granted and wasted what you have given us. Transform our hearts and minds so that we may learn to share and care with our neighbor. May we touch the earth with gentleness and love, and respect the rights of all people and species. In the midst of turbulence, let our church make space for the hearing of your still, small voice, that we may be a community of peacemakers and bridge builders, to reflect your love, peace, and hope to a world that so desperately needs your presence and healing. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let us lift our voices in faith to God, who hears all prayers and holds close all in need, as we pray the calling for purity. Almighty God,
to whom all
are open, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthy magnify your holy name, your Christ our Lord. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Rend your hearts and not your garments, and return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Let us confess our sins, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with our neighbor. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of you. Hear then these words of grace, and know that your sins are forgiven. I have swept away your offences like a cloud, your sins like the morning mist. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. We pray the calling together up on the screen. O God of love, your embrace includes everyone. Open our hearts and minds to your changes.
Let anyone who slays
and do
replace Christ's love
and serve the need of our neighbors.
Through our Lord Jesus Christ,
the Lord and Angel, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Seven is our reader today. The first reading is taken from Psalm chapter 125. Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken but endures forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people both now and forevermore. The scepter of the wicked will not remain over the land allotted to the righteous, For then the righteous might use their hands to do evil. Lord, do good to those who are good, to those who are upright in heart. But those who turn to crooked ways, the Lord will banish with the evildoers. Peace be on Israel. The second reading is James chapter 2, verses 1 to 17. My brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ must not show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy old clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, "Here's a good seat for you," but say to the poor man, "You stand there or sit on the floor at my feet," have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. It is not the rich who are exploiting you. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are blaspheming the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not commit murder." If you do not commit adultery, but do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, "Go in peace, keep warm and well fed," but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accomplished by action, is dead. Here ends the reading.
Thank you.
We welcome Jeremy Jobbery, our preacher and celebrant.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning to those that are joining us online now or in the future. My name is Jeremy. It's really good to be with you this morning. My wife Brenda in the front and daughters Ruth and Nikki are with me. I've been involved in Christian ministry for over 22 years, including a 5-year stint just down the road at Christ Church Kenilworth. And so it's good to be back in the parish of St. John's Wynberg. Love this place and these people. Brenda and I feel very at home coming here because when we first moved to Cape Town, because St. John's Parish opened up their arms and welcomed us as a family. Now Ruth, our oldest, is a homeschooler, and she's preparing for an exam at the moment. And one of the ways we prepare for the exam together is look at past papers. And so we go through some of the past exam papers, as you do if you're a school student or varsity student. Any students here? Anyone managing to study amidst COVID, keeping the concentration going? Well, today I want to give you a self-exam that you can do, a practice paper if you like. I'm going to ask you a question that I'd like you to answer for yourself. But before I ask the question, I'm going to give you a little test, which will hopefully help you. Before I give you the question, I just want to tell you there's going to be a test which will hopefully help you to answer the question better. Okay, so the test is 3 questions. It's the practice paper for the real thing, which is this question. How much do I need Jesus in my life? That's the real exam that we're looking at this morning. How much do I need Jesus in my life? It's a question I want you to try to ask of yourself this morning as we look at God's Word together. Now James, the brother of Jesus, he's probably the one who wrote this letter that was just read to us from James. They debate whether it was the brother of Jesus or the disciple or another James. But it's addressed to Jewish followers who are outside of Israel, scattered. And he's the one who actually sets today's test paper. He says these words, "Judgment without mercy will be shown to those who have not been merciful, because mercy triumphs over judgment." Mercy triumphs over judgment. I believe I can take this off. There we go, now you can see my whole face. Let's pray as we start. Lord Jesus, as we look at your word this morning, we pray that you would open our hearts and speak life to our hearts and our minds this morning. We want to see Jesus. Amen. So are you ready for the test? Question number one. Do I show favoritism or discriminate against the poor? It's the first question James is asking as he addresses us this morning. He says it like this, "Brothers and sisters, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism." Then he goes on to give the example of two people walking into church. So I want you to imagine this morning, two people walking into church. The first is Mayor of Cape Town, Dan Plato, comes in. Just imagine, he walks in, fills in the register, sanitizes his hands. I get quite excited. There's the mayor. I've never met him in person. It'd be quite nice if he knew my name. Go over and introduce myself. So, "Come, Mr. Mayor, it's really good to have you here." He's even wearing his gold chain that the mayor wears. Give him the seat at the front here. "Come and sit down, please. It's really good to have you with us. Please enjoy the service. Let's have a cup of tea afterwards. It'd be great to catch up." Actually, I don't drink tea, so it'd be coffee. And then, my friend Shane walks in. Shane comes to our gate. Or perhaps it could be Freddie and Irene, who sleep on the doorstep, just up the steps here. But let's say Shane. Shane comes in. Shane normally comes at inconvenient times. He's a pain in the neck. He asks and asks and asks. He wants everything. And he smells a bit and he's dressed a bit shabby. So Shane, I'm a bit embarrassed, he's here. "Come, let me take you to the back. There's a place for you back there. Let's leave these seats for the usual congregation." James says, "Shame on you. Shame on you. You discriminate against the poor. You can't be like this. This is how the world respects the rich and disregards the poor. And the church should look different." In Proverbs 22, verse 2, we read, "Rich and poor have this in common. The Lord is the maker of them all." So he doesn't distinguish. He makes us all, rich and poor. He loves us all. He made us all. He's got a place for us all. But we distinguish. And maybe it's not here as people walk in the door of the church. Maybe it's in other ways. Maybe it's at my gate. Maybe it's the people I regard or disregard in the street, or at the shop, or in my place of work. But James goes on to say just how absurd it is that believers would honor the rich and dishonor the poor. He says, "Is it not the rich who are exploiting you?" Because believers at that time were being exploited by the rich. "Are they not the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the noble name of him to whom you belong?" He's saying, isn't it ironic that you show these guys high regard, but the poor, you just disregard them? Believers were literally being dragged into court for their faith. Last night, I watched a documentary with my family about 9/11 and the terrorist attacks on America, in which they interviewed the previous president, George Bush. And included in it were some of his speeches, and these words stuck out to me from the speech that he made on the evening of 9/11. So the Twin Towers had been shot down by these passenger planes. A plane had gone into the Pentagon, another one had been overcome. You know the story of nearly 3,000 people had died on that day. It was shocking to America, it was shocking to the world. And George Bush said these quite harsh words in his speech that evening. He said, We will make no distinction between the terrorists who committed these acts and those who harbour them. Sure, these words sunk in. But gosh, a lot of innocent countries where Al-Qaeda might be, are you saying you hold them responsible as well? Now back to James. James is saying to us something very similar. If you show favoritism for the rich who have exploited the poor, then you too are exploiting the poor, even if you don't think you do it yourself. So be very careful how you act in this regard. In his autobiography, Mahatma Gandhi wrote that during his student days he read the Gospels seriously and considered converting to Christianity. He believed that in Jesus he could find the solution to the caste system that was dividing the people of India. So one Sunday he decided to go to a church in Calcutta and test this out. When he entered the sanctuary, however, the usher refused to give him a seat and suggested that he go and worship with his own people, that he wasn't the right caste or the right colour. This was a white British Calcutta church, and there were other churches for people like him. Gandhi left the church and never returned. If Christians have caste differences also, he said, I might as well remain Hindu. Gandhi wrote, I like your Christ, but not your Christianity. That usher's prejudice that day not only betrayed Jesus, but also turned a man away from finding salvation in Jesus. In what ways do I show favoritism towards people because they are poor, because they are not like me, based on how they look or based on their circumstances? Do I discriminate against the poor? I think my answer to this question reveals something of the poverty in my own heart, or perhaps just how little I can identify with the desperate needs of the poor. One who comes to my gate and says, please. There's a regular guy who comes, we call him the milkman, because he often asks for milk for his young children. Please, can I have some milk today? My children are desperate. Do we come with that same desperate, Jesus, I need you in my life so much right now? Question number two. How are you doing on the test? Are we okay? Okay. Number two. Who are the poor? James doesn't ask this question directly, but he wrote these words. Has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and inherit the kingdom that he promised to those who love him? Has not God chosen the poor? It's a rhetorical question. James knows the answer. It's a resounding yes, he has. He's chosen the poor. Not exclusively, but he's saying they know something that it's hard to know if you're comfortable enough. God has chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom that he promised to those who love him. In Matthew and Mark's Gospels, there's a story that's set for today's readings, which we didn't read, about a woman in Tyre, the town of Tyre. Tyre is a little town just 20 kilometers north of the Israeli border in what's current-day Lebanon, modern-day Lebanon, on the coast. And Jesus took a trip up there. And it was a heathen, a Gentile town. And when he was there, there was a woman who heard about him. They called her also the Canaanite woman or the Syrophoenician woman. She was a Greek. She was a Gentile. She wasn't Jewish. It wasn't who the Messiah was for. So they thought. And this woman comes to Jesus and literally begs him. She says, my daughter is possessed by a demon. Please, you've got to help. Please. In Matthew's account of the story, the disciples actually chase her away. They try and say, please, let's get her out of here. She's a nuisance. And Jesus says to the woman, first let the children eat all that they want, for it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Any of us reading this passage should think this is unbelievable. Why would Jesus refer to this woman as a dog who's looking for the children's food? What a strange metaphor to use. What a shocking thing for Jesus to say. And It sounded first glance like Jesus was saying, no, I won't heal your daughter. I've come for the Jews, not the Gentiles. Who are you to come and steal the children's food? Children of Israel. He insults her, calls her a dog. Is Jesus actually behaving like a bigoted racist? What's going on here? It's shocking on the face of it. What we believe and understand as we read the context and the situation is that Jesus was using the language of parable, which he often used. And the woman was wise. The woman was chasing after the heart of God. So she saw something that others, even the disciples perhaps, did not see. And the Pharisees definitely did not see. You see, the key word here is the bread, not the dogs. And often we get stuck on the dogs. Bread. Because later Jesus will refer to himself as the bread of life. The Messiah, the bread of life. I've come to feed you, to satisfy your needs. And the woman got it. She must have recognized Jesus as the bread of life, because she says to him, Lord, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. In other words, who gets to put a limit on Messiah's bread? Who can say, who gets Jesus? I want some of them too. Surely there's enough for everyone. If the household pets can eat the crumbs under the table, the children will still survive on the food they have. It's not like they're going to starve. There's enough for everyone, Jews and Gentiles, rich and poor. And the wonderful thing is in this story, Jesus sees her, he recognizes her, he heals her daughter, and he even says to her, woman, you have great faith. Great faith. Not many people he said that to. In fact, just a bit later, he says to the disciples when they're bickering about bread and the Pharisees, where is your faith? Why don't you have it? Why do you have so little faith? Don't you see that I feed the 4,000, I feed the 5,000, there's enough bread for everyone? But actually, it's not about this bread, it's about this bread. When Jesus said to the woman, first let the children eat all they want, he was referring to the Jews. And the word he used for eat all that they want is a word which means be satisfied. They will be satisfied. It's a word only used three times. There in that story, in Mark, it's used three times. And also in the feeding of the 4,000 and the 5,000. Now in those stories, Jesus fed so many people off a few loaves and fishes. And it says all of them were satisfied, like this woman was satisfied, like he promised to satisfy her need. All of them were satisfied, and there were leftovers, baskets and baskets, baskets of leftovers. Jesus even reminded the disciples when they were bickering, where's your faith? Don't you see there's more than enough of me for everyone to be satisfied, rich and poor, Jew and Gentile. So don't hold back. Don't be greedy. Hold on to me because I'm for everyone. So who are the poor? This is from a poem by an unknown author. Who are the poor? Me? You? Always someone else? Always the other? Are there only orphans living in third world countries? Are there starving children? The oppressed? Children forced to beg for food? Those without clean water or basic sanitation? How about the widow living down the road alone? Or the homeless who go through my village? My neighbor? Those the world's forgotten? Those needing to reclaim their dignity? Are the impoverished those who have too little, or those with plenty thinking they don't have enough? Are the poor to be pitied or helped, maligned or blessed, abandoned or rescued, brought down or lifted up? Are they indifferent to or loved by God? Are they irresponsible or responsible recipients of extreme circumstances? Who then are the poor? They are creative, they are beautiful, they are open, they are intensely loved by God, divinely created, a blessing, an opportunity to be like Jesus in the world. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So test question number two, who are poor? As we look to this question, perhaps my answer to this question reveals not only the poverty out there, but also shows something, again, about my own heart. My deep need for the bread of life, for Jesus to satisfy my greatest need today. Question number three, last question on the test, get ready. Do I speak and act with mercy towards the poor? James writes in chapter 2, verse 12, speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful, for mercy triumphs over judgment. Mercy triumphs over judgment. But what does James mean by speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom? What's this law that gives freedom? Why will we be judged by a law that gives freedom? The Apostle Paul agrees with James. He also speaks of this law that gives freedom. He says, now the law of the Spirit of life in Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. He recognizes two laws. And what he's saying is, there's a law by which you can try and earn God's approval. And you'll never be good enough. You'll never get it. There's another law, freedom, by which Jesus has already earned the right for us to be favored by God when we put our faith in him. In other words, when you put your faith and trust in Jesus, you don't get the judgment you deserve, I deserve. Rather, we receive God's mercy. We were completely impoverished, in poverty, in our ability to have a relationship with God. Because of our sin, because of the state in our world, until he showed us his mercy. And because he has shown us his mercy, we must speak and act as those who've received mercy. You see? We don't have to try to speak and act with mercy. We first recognize God has seen me with his mercy. I've received his mercy, so I want to be merciful. There's a wonderful man I heard speak. He's written a book called Just Mercy. His name is Brian Stevenson. He's a human rights lawyer. In his book, Just Mercy, was this story, which I just thought illustrated this so well. What does it mean to turn around our judgments and turn it into mercy, and what comes of it? So I'm going to read from his book, Just Mercy. Brian Stevenson writes, when I was a boy, my mother took me to church. When I was about 10 years old, I was outside of our church with my friends, and one of them had brought a visiting relative to the service. The visiting child was a shy, skinny boy, about my height, who was clinging to his cousin nervously. He didn't say anything as the group of us chatted away. I asked him where he was from, and when this child tried to speak, he stumbled horribly. He had a severe speech impediment and couldn't get his mouth to cooperate. He couldn't even say the name of the town where he lived. I'd never seen someone stutter like that. I thought he must have been joking or playing around, so I laughed. My friend looked at me worriedly, but I didn't stop laughing. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw my mother looking at me with an expression I'd never seen before. It was the mix of horror, anger, and shame, all focused on me. It stopped my laughing instantly. I'd always felt adored by my mom, so I was unnerved when she pulled me over. When I got to her, she was angry with me. What are you doing? What? I didn't do. Don't you ever laugh at someone because they can't get their words out right. Don't you ever do that. I'm sorry. I was devastated to be reprimanded by my mom so harshly. Mom, I didn't mean to do anything wrong. You should know better, Brian. I'm sorry, I thought, I don't want to hear it, Brian. There's no excuse and I'm very disappointed in you. Now I want you to go back there and tell that little boy you're sorry. Yes, ma'am. Then I want you to give that little boy a hug. Huh? Then I want you to tell him that you love him. I looked up at her, and to my horror, saw that she was dead serious. I'd reacted as apologetically as I possibly could, but this was way too much. Mom, I can't go over there and tell that boy I love him. Please, people will... She gave me that look again, and I somberly turned around and returned to my group of friends. They had obviously seen my mother scolding. I could tell because they were all staring at me. I went up to the little boy who had struggled to speak. Look, man, I'm sorry. I was genuinely apologetic for laughing and even more deeply regretful of the situation I put myself in. I looked over at my mother, who was still staring at me. I lunged at the boy to give him a very awkward hug. I think I startled him by grabbing him like that, but when he realized what I was trying to do, his body relaxed and he hugged me back. My friends looked at me oddly as I spoke. I love you. I tried to say it as insincerely as I could get away with and half smiled as I spoke. I was still hugging the boy, so he couldn't see the disingenuous look on my youthful face. It made me feel less weird to smile like it was a joke, but then the boy hugged me tighter and whispered in my ear. He spoke flawlessly, without a stutter, without hesitation. I love you too. There was such tenderness and earnestness in his voice. Just like that, I thought I would stop crying. Do I speak and act with mercy for the poor? Perhaps my answer to this question reveals something of how much I realize I have or I haven't received God's mercy. So as I close, back to the question, the main question, how much do I need Jesus in my life? How much do I realize that I've come like one of the gates, desperate? Lord, I have you in my life. Maybe I've had you for years. But I realize my life still needs you so much. And it's not enough. I realize that you give and you give again, and you want to keep giving me your Holy Spirit. I need you. Would we sit like this and think, God, I've got enough of you, thank you. Got it all together. Just trying to keep it together. How much do we need Jesus in our lives? Recognizing the poverty in my own spirit is the starting place of hunger for Jesus. A story and a lesson from James in caring for the poor is maybe an invitation to start at home and say, how poor am I? What have I received from God? What does he want to still give me? The changes in my mind about how I respond to the poor around me, however they look, whoever they are. Our response to Jesus is everything. In Psalm 125, the psalmist writes, those who put their faith, their trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion and cannot be shaken. When you turn to him and to his mercy and his grace, he is your steady stronghold. There's one bread of life, it's Jesus. And we who are many, one body, we all share in one bread. His grace and mercy and the power of his blood shed at Calvary is everything we need. And to hunger for him when he's already filled you is to say, I need all of you, Lord. I need more of your spirit. Let us pray. This is just an invitation to open your hands to God this morning. A sign of an open heart that says, God, I need everything you've got. There are places in my life where I'm holding back from others, where I'm not generous, where I show discrimination. But maybe it's because of a deficit in my own heart. And so we open our hands and we say, come, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, won't you fill us afresh this morning? We need you. We need your power, we need your love, your mercy flowing through our lives. You're such a good God. Just come, Lord, fill each of us in this room, watching online. Just fill our hearts this morning, today, with your love. and help us to keep on seeking you when we're not in a place of hunger for you. Won't you even give us the gift of hunger to strive after you and all that you have for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Offer van us weer in this coming to lead us in prayer.
Lord God, Father, our Creator, Jesus, our bread of life, Holy Spirit, our sustainer. In faith we come to you, Lord. Lord, thank you that you've been God who's responded to our needs. We've asked many times and you've responded to it. You've heard us and you've answered our prayer. Thank you, Lord, for that. It is with that confidence that we can come again to intercede for ourselves and for the world. Lord, give to your church holiness. Lord, we ask you to bring wholeness to our congregation. Bring us back to the heart of worship. Create in us an increase in a Christ-like life, which brings honor to your name. We pray for those outside the walls of our church. Those who are engaged in bringing Jesus to a lost world. We hold for you organizations like Scripture Union, AMI, OMF. We also ask you to help us see where we fit into your plan for outreach. We pray for our churches. We engage in the Bridges of Love exercise as we reach out to each other in this church to bring your love. And we also pray for those who are called to full-time ministry in your kingdom. Lord, give peace to our world. Afghanistan is top of the agenda in the world today. And we also pray for a solution for the continuous simmering relationships between Israel and Palestine. Lord, you are the solution, and we just pray that your hand would be upon it. We pray for the many countries in Africa torn with strife caused by unjust government, religious intolerance, terrorism. Lord, look with compassion on the millions who suffer as a result of these injustices. And we pray for the more powerful countries in this world that they would have a presence and work justly in the impoverished countries around. Lord, we pray to keep our families safe. We pray for parents. May they have love for their children. May you help them to provide for them as well. Give them wisdom and understanding, Yahshua, and courage to raise children in a world which is as difficult as ours is. And we pray particularly for children going to school, the disruptions that are at present existing there. Work in the hearts and minds of these young people. Just have a space to pray for the needs in our own families. Lord, we pray that you protect the weak. We think of orphans, children in our childhood homes. We pray for the widows. Remember the elderly, the marginalized. Prisoners. We pray for the sick. Lord, we pray especially for those folk who suffering from COVID. We pray especially for those who are dying to be comforted by you. We also pray for those suffering from HIV and AIDS, TB. And people who suffer from Alzheimer's, dementia. Lord, have mercy on them. Lord, have mercy. Speak into their presence, Lord. Lord, send them to the care of the sick. Our nurses and doctors and scientists and many others. We pray that you will give them the resources to bring healing to our diseases. Lord, there are many other things for which we need to intercede. But you know our needs before we ask. Lord, out of your compassion, your grace, mercy. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
We'd like to stand for the peace. There's one notice apparently from Mary Holgate that she's still building bridges of love. Does that make sense to everyone? listen to the words of Jesus I give you a new commandment, love one another. As I have loved you, so are you to love one another. If there is this love among you, the world will know that you are my disciples. And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Peace be with you.
Let's greet each other with peace.
Oh.
seeks the faith of those who persevere. Though they fall, they'll never fear. The kingdom is yours. Yeah, the kingdom is yours.
Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For he is your living Word, through whom you've created all things from the beginning, and formed us in your own image. Through him you freed us from the slavery of sin, giving him to be born as man and to die upon the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him you've sent upon us your holy and life-giving Spirit, and made us a people for your own possession. So with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you, and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us, his body and his blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and gave you thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. So, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross and proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. As we look for his coming in glory, we celebrate that this bread and this cup is one perfect sacrifice. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. through him, with him, in him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, and worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise, blessing, honour, glory and power, be yours forever and ever.
Amen.
He sits on the altar to pray. And as Christ has taught us, we call to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in
heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and give us our sins, and forgive those who sin
against us. Save us from the time of trial, deliver us from the evil. Kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Bread which we break. Is it not a sharing of the body of Christ? So, brothers and sisters, draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he has given for us, and his blood that he shed for us. Feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
to the Lord, for he is gracious.
He is mercy.
We pray together the prayer of self-offering. Father Almighty, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out into the world in the power of your Holy Spirit to live and work unto your praise and glory. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always. Amen. We stand together to sing our final song.
Blessed assurance, Jesus.
Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. There is salvation, purchased of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood.
My soul, praising my soul.
be a missed opportunity if anyone has come, or maybe someone's come here today with a particular need or burden that you're carrying on your shoulders, and that you need Jesus to meet with you in that place this morning. And if that's you and you'd like someone to pray with you, then perhaps you could just come over to the site here afterwards and I'll be there. Maybe there are others who could pray, but we'd love to pray for you. We'll keep masks on, an appropriate distance, but just the opportunity for some prayer. Thank you, Brandon.
Pray the prayer for Africa. God
bless Africa.
Protect our children. Transform our leaders. Heal our communities.
And restore our unity. And give us peace.
For Jesus Christ's sake.
Amen.
To a troubled world.
Peace on Christ.
To a searching world.
Love on Christ.
To a waiting world.
Love on Christ.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
And amen. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Come again next week.